was horrifying to watch that the new evidence of the chemical gas attack that took place in April, in a sense, just gasping for a last breath, many of them children. Now, the man you're about to meet now is a former activist. He is a former rebel fighter. He narrowly survived a sarin gas attack in Syria in August of 2013, and he joins us via Skype from Germany, where he now lives. And Kassem, thank you so much for joining us here on the program. When you see that video, this new evidence of children choking on their last breaths, and as a survivor and as someone who knows this war so intimately, how does it make you feel?
I actually feel speechless. I've been watching those pictures and videos. I've watched them myself with my own eyes for years and years. And the fact that those pictures and videos and people are still dying in such a horrible way in 2017 makes me feel nauseous. I really can't express my anger in words. I tried for many years to talk, to scream, to write, to protest, to do anything, everything I can, along with thousands and thousands of other people, trying to bring help for the Syrian people to stop the lunatic Bashar al-Assad from committing war crimes. But unfortunately, we live in a world made of hypocrisy. When it comes to Syria, people are not considered real people. They were not considered humans. We're just considered statistics and collateral damage for a lot of countries. But I think the thing that makes me angry the most is the fact that President Obama lied to the United States, to the American people, and to the entire world that he took all of Bashar al-Assad's chemical weapons. And he lied again when he said that he will give Bashar a pass in case he will give him his chemical weapons. So he lied twice, and the cause of his lies was women and children getting gassed to death. 500,000 people were killed by the Assad regime, and President Obama did nothing, absolutely nothing, for more than 6 years. He just kept making false statements about how Assad should go and how this is against international law, but on the ground, he did a lot of efforts to keep Assad in power. He stopped a lot of countries from arming the rebels with the necessary weapons to take Assad down or to establish safe zones. He stood against almost every effort by the international community to actually bring an end for the Syrian atrocity. I really cannot understand how someone can be that horrible, and how can he say such nice words. When people hear him talk, they think he's a good person. But when you see his action, you will see the exact opposite.
And Kassem, with this new video evidence of what happened in that Syrian gas attack in April, we don't see politics, we don't see grandstanding, we don't see statistics. We see death, we see a war crime, we see the immediate aftermath of a chemical attack. This was something that you experienced. You lived through it. What was that like?
Well, I lived for more than 2 years under government siege in my hometown, Wad Damiyya, which is the western suburb of the capital, Damascus. This is all started when we asked for freedom, when we marched in the streets asking for freedom and democracy, asking for free elections in our country, and the government responded by bullets and tanks and aircrafts. After almost living 2 years under siege, without power, without gas, with daily bombardment, with hundreds of people who got killed, on August 21st, 2013, also in the early morning, I heard alarms coming from Damascus. Rockets hit the ground. Seconds later, I lost my ability to breathe or talk. I started beating my chest to be able to do anything, to speak. And I got my first breath. It was the most painful feeling I ever experienced in my life. I started screaming in agony. So did the neighbors. I ran to the street to figure out what's going on. And I saw what I always describe as Judgment Day, because I saw men, women, and children running, falling on the ground, suffocating. The terror, the agony, the fear, the confusion that was in the air was unbearable. I tried to rescue a little boy who was suffocating. And by the time I got into the field hospital with the help of the Free Syrian Army, that boy was dead. And I lost my conscience. And the doctors thought that I was also dead because my heart stopped. I was in a coma. And I was placed among the dead bodies until my friends noticed that I was still moving. The doctors came again and gave me more atropine and CPR and washed my body over and over with water until I woke up. I woke up among piles of dead bodies of women and children. My friends took me outside just to see, just try to get some fresh air because the air was contaminated in the basement, which was the field hospital, the only field hospital we had underground. By the time we got there, the regime started bombing each and every corner of our town. They were trying to invade. They sent their special forces. They were wearing full military, full chemical gear protection and trying to kill whoever remained alive. And if it wasn't for the bravery of the Free Syrian Army, we would have been all killed that day. A few days later, I helped the United Nations Weapons Inspectors team. 5 days later, I helped them investigate the incident in our town. They examined evidence and blood samples and everything, and they wrote a full report that shows clearly that Assad regime was responsible. I remember that attack with the most painful memory, to be watching President Obama failing to fulfill his red line promise and letting Assad walk away unpunished after gassing 1,400 people to death in one day. And he lied, like I mentioned earlier, about taking all of Assad's chemical weapons. I knew it. A lot of people knew it. The OPCW was talking about it. A lot of foreign intelligence agency was talking and saying that Assad still have chemical weapons. But President Obama kept lying and insisted that, no, he doesn't have chemical weapons anymore. And what happened in Khan Sheikhoun was a proof on President Obama's hypocrisy. And I can also say that it was somehow he was a part of that crime because he had the tools and the power to stop the lunatic from committing the war crimes, but he just let him go without any kind of punishment. This is really disgusting. I don't know how he can be a father for two beautiful girls and a husband for such a beautiful woman and not to think about those poor families that they were gassed to death. I want to ask him if he's listening right now. What if your children were gassed to death? What if it was your wife who died from the sarin gas? What would you do if I was you and I let the man who committed that war crime unpunished? What would you think of me? What would you think of me?
That's a pointed question that every world leader should be asking themselves. And politics aside, we thank you for sharing a very stirring and horrific account of just the impact of chemical warfare and how you were once thought to be dead, brought back to life after what you experienced, a gas attack, a sarin gas attack in 2013. You've been speaking out ever since. Karim, thank you so much for joining us here on the program, and take care. You're watching News.